So, I'd like to begin this talk with a little quotation. It's from David Enoch, and I think if you were here for John's talk at the beginning of today, it's almost, I feel like David Enoch and Joseph Raz are like the ghosts that hang over the top of debates about disagreement amongst like minds that we might find here today. And in this quote, he says, "Look, I don't know any other philosophical discussion that's just quite like it. Talk to broadly speaking Rawlsians, and you are quite likely to get the impression that some kind of political liberalism or public reason account is the only game in town. The only question worth discussing seems are within this framework rather than about it. Theorists who reject this framework are often ignored, and the feeling one gets is that they just don't get it. Talk to many others, and you are likely to get the impression that rules in public reason have been effectively refuted several times over. And indeed, that even this much, was never necessary, as the theory was a non-starter to begin with. And the feeling one gets is that Rawlsians just don't get it, and that their tremendous influence in political philosophy is corrupting the field." So that's kind of how Enoch feels on the other side of the fence. That no one's really got him. And if we only just listened more to him, we would. So in my way, I kind of want to sort of embrace that picture of what's going on dialectically and try to address that from the other side, from someone who does, broadly speaking, might be called a political liberal, and broadly speaking, someone who's going to take disagreement seriously, unlike David Enoch, Joseph Raz, and other perfectionists. And so in order to do this, I want to... My talk is in two parts. The first is an attempt, kind of an exegetical attempt, to try and to identify what I think is the source of this disagreement between Rawlsians and non-Rawlsians, to use Enoch's own language. And then I want to, having kind of identified that, what I think is that, you know, the kind of the source of the disagreement about the foundational significance of disagreement, so to speak, I want to then offer an argument for why the Rawlsians and others, the public reason people, the John Kongs of this world, are right. That perfectionists... But I want to explain it in a way that tries to do with this feeling. I want to explain it in a way that I think David Enoch might be able to get it. You present this talk to David Enoch about, you know, 3 or 4 months ago, and I can report he didn't seem to get it. But maybe he needs to just think about it a little bit more. And as you'll see, that won't stop me thinking that I can forcibly coerce my political liberal paradise on him, even though he doesn't agree with me. Here's kind of a roadmap of my talk. First of all, I'm going to talk about the source of disagreement. The answer I'm going to put forward is something called the basic proposition, which is an understanding of what it means for people to be free and equal, in a very specific meaning, that each individual has fundamental authority over herself and herself alone. And this is something I argue for extensively in other work, but I need to present it here for you to understand what on earth I'm talking about today. The real focus of my material will be for the argument for the truth of the basic proposition. And my strategy, as I said, is I'm going to start with the perfectionist's own realist sort of meta-ethical premises and assumptions, and try to work to the opposite of their own conclusion. And the key insight I'm going to be pushing for is this: that any rational act made on the basis of what we believe is best, all things considered, involves taking unquantifiable risk that our belief is false, and we therefore need to believe that there is a reason to take that risk. We need to have a belief, the reason to take that unquantifiable risk in a certain way. And then I'm going to reply to some objections. Okay. So let's start off with the source of the disagreement about the foundational significance of disagreement. So my claim, and I've got to flesh that out a little bit, but really I just kind of want to leave it as a stipulation largely for this talk, is that the disagreement between political liberals, Rawlsians, whatever, and perfectionists is that the former and not the latter, hold what I shall call the basic proposition to be true. So what do I mean by that? Basic proposition is a particular understanding of the claim that we are all free and equal. Each individual has fundamental authority over herself and herself alone. And the idea is that when political liberals get to the real basis of their arguments, the real kind of foundation stone of their arguments, it's a kind of trickles down to the end, or well, why in the end are you holding on to this position? They often say, well, it just seems that we have to be political liberals in order to treat people as equals. And what I argue elsewhere is that we need to investigate what do they actually mean by that conception of basic equality. And I argue that when you look at the social contract tradition that political liberals, amongst others, inheriting, what they really mean is some claim like this, that each person has fundamental authority over themselves and themselves alone. It's very different, actually, to the conception of equal moral worth, which is another way in which people seem to understand what it means to be equals in a very basic sense. Now, I have a kind of more elaborate conception of what this proposition means. And it's useful to have it up here for the purpose of my argument, but I accept that I'm probably going to have a bit of a beef with other political liberals as precisely whether this is right. But the most important element to see here is that there is a positive element as well as a negative element to the basic proposition. One can give oneself decisive reasons to act by determining that we should do something, not merely that no one else can. And you might be a little bit suspicious that I've gone completely off track with this, but this is the type of claim that I think is foundational, or most obviously foundational, to someone like Locke. See, here's Locke. That all men by nature are equal, I cannot be supposed to mean any, you know, all sorts of equality. Instead, I mean something very specific. Very specifically, the equality which all men are in respect of jurisdiction or dominion over one another, which was the equality I there spoke of as a prosperous business in hand, being that equal right every man hath for his natural freedom without being subject to the will or authority of any other man. And two, just because he's here, here's John Kwong. We correctly think of ourselves as free and equal from the moral point of view. That is to say, we all have the same moral status as free persons, i.e. as people who are not naturally under the authority of someone else. But this is what I think it means to be an equal. When you really drill down for these philosophers. And you might think, well, there's no positive element there in those conceptions. Well, I think that positive element is necessary if you want to know why it is that when we start agreeing to do things, or some sort of kind of upscale version of agreement, like a public justification principle, why it actually gives any reasons for us to do anything at all. It is by agreeing to something. So typically in a contract, we give ourselves decisive reason to do whatever the contract says. So for my purposes, that counts as some sort of positive exercise of authority. Okay, so just to fill out a bit more why this seems to be the source of the fundamental disagreement between political liberals and perfectionists, the claim is this. If you hold the basic proposition, it creates what we might call the basic problem of politics. Yeah. Here we are, all in some sort of seemingly state of nature where no one has authority over anyone else. Naturally, fundamentally, how on earth are we going to get towards justifying a government that supposedly has authority over us? And of course, the social contract answer to that, the only way in which it's somehow consistent to have these two is for us to all agree. It's like an exercise of fundamental authority justifies the derivative authority of the state. And that kind of reasoning is what is it then kind of inherited by the political liberal tradition. And of course, I'm talking very broad terms about a number of different theories, but then it's going to be sort of sublimated and understood as something like a public justification principle, hypothetical consent, constructive consent, some sort of exclusion of ideals principle. They're all operating off the same fundamental set of intuitions. So hence, on the other time, the flip side of this, of course, is that state authority then cannot be justified when there is disagreement, when there isn't agreement. So this is my case of why, when we kind of looked when we put political liberals down on the psychotherapy map, we try to work out why it is they seem to care about disagreement so much. I think this is why. And it also explains why perfectionists don't. Why? Because perfectionists just don't hold basic propositions. They think it doesn't really seem to make sense to them. All right? Authority is fundamentally something that people have over others, for example, rather than over themselves. And authority is going to be justified on something like the service conception. And the service conception says, well, there's a whole realm of reasons out there. Your job is to go out there and try and conform with those reasons. And tell you what, following someone else better allows you to conform to those reasons than trying to do it to yourself, then that person has authority over you. So the perfectionist, what I'm trying to say here, is that the source of the disagreement is that the perfectionists reject the basic proposition, and the political liberals, implicitly at least, and sometimes explicitly, hold on to it. Okay, I suppose one final point to say is I've introduced the basic proposition as an understanding of what it means for people to be free and equal. Does that mean that perfectionists therefore reject the idea that people are free and equal? Well, they have to, at least the sense that I put forward, but their strategy is probably going to be to reinterpret freedom and equality as being something else. For example, to be equals is to have equal moral worth. For each one piece of utility in you, to be worth one piece of utility in others. Or you might go the more radical strategy of Joseph Raz and just write equality off completely. Okay, so that is the state of play, I think, in the current debate. And I've only introduced this really to kind of trying to now make a move within this framework. And I want to make a move that tries to make an argument for this basic proposition. So my strategy is to try and start with the perfectionist's own metaethical premises and with their own assumptions and trying to show that on the basis of their own assumptions, they should accept the basic proposition. Okay. So here are the kind of basic premises, realist premises, that I want to explicitly adopt. You know, the first is that reasons for actions are facts that count in favour of a particular action and thus ultimately independent of the beliefs that we have about them. And then a lot of this was what John was talking about in the MAR response, and it's something that Enoch and Raz have really been pressing, which is that reasons for actions are out there, they're facts, but reasons as believed themselves are not reasons at all. It's true that sometimes the fact that we have a certain belief, can be ground a reason to act, but only derivatively of ultimately something that is independent of belief. So for example, autonomy is independent of a belief that we have a reason of autonomy to promote, but that will mean derivatively, if I have a certain belief in, say, I want to be in a particular religion, then that reason of autonomy means that that fact that I have that belief will give me a reason to act under that belief, or at least for you to allow me to do so. Okay. Secondly, it is one of the requirements of rationality that if one believes that one has best reason all things to aid, then one aids. This is something John Broome dubs encrasia. And then finally, ceteris paribus, one may be justified in acting upon what one believes to be what one has the best reason to do all things considered, even if that belief is false. I mean, there's some complications about that, but that is not going to be central to my argument. Okay, so that's roughly, I think, what the type of premises the realist uses when they're on the front foot to try and dismiss the relevance of disagreement in moral action and politics. And so I want to therefore start with those premises. I also now want to make the realists accept what I call some structural facts. And I think they're going to do that, although they're going to do it through gritted teeth and they're going to feel a bit dirty about it. The first one is the fact of what I call structural fallibility. I can't exclude the possibility that any of my beliefs, my moral beliefs may be false, and I have no non-circular method of determining that possibility is likely. Now, I mean, this is something I think that's quite natural You might think to a child when you ask, but why do you believe that? But why do you believe that? But why do you believe that? And at some time you bottom out. And we have lots of different theories, of epistemological theories, but in the end I think all of them are going to bottom out in something that looks like this. And I think because the idea is to quantify the risk that you're wrong, you have to defer out to your other beliefs in order to assess the likelihood of a particular belief being wrong, and of course those beliefs themselves might be wrong. So there's no kind of point which we can stand outside of our beliefs to work out, well, what is the chance the whole system is false? And that's not, hence it's unquantifiable for us. Now, this is not a this itself does not entail skepticism. I think there's a disconnect between this fact about a belief and the fact that we can still believe from within the system. We clearly do. But this is, as it were, you might think, a fact that conditions our beliefs. It exists there all the time. Here's a second fact. And this is the fact of what I call the fact of structural epistemic authority. We must always take ourselves out of ultimate epistemic authority about epistemic authority. What do I mean? It's the thought that when John kind of quoted Raz, when he said, even in deferring to judgment, to someone else's judgment, we have to use our own judgment, that we should have deferred to that judgment. So it doesn't mean that we always take ourselves to know best. But in trying to work out whether we do know best or not, whether someone else does, we have to refer to one person alone in that reasoning process, which is ourselves and our own judgment about who knows best. And once again, it's just a fact that conditions seemingly the way we have to think about things. So the conjunction of these leads to what I think I call the fact of structural risk. The first fact, actually. Every act we perform on the basis of our belief about what we have most reason to do involves an unquantifiable risk that we do not best conform to reason because our beliefs may be false. So the picture here is that acting is a risky business. Acting according to our own beliefs is a risky business. And I think when you the realist has to accept that. And I think the picture therefore we get from the realist is that the realist knows what should they do? Well, they should do whatever in truth out there in Plato's heaven is what they should have most reason to do. But they also know, given the structural facts, that we exist in Plato's cave. And in Plato's cave, we know there's an unquantifiable risk that we haven't got it right. Right? And there's no way in which we can step outside of beliefs and kind of measure even how close we've got. So, but the model of action on the perfectionist view is, well, but it's only rational to step forth and take that risk, no matter, despite it. So there is a kind of, and what I want to argue is, there's something wrong with that picture. There's something wrong with the picture that takes no account of the fact that you've decided to take the structural risk, and you haven't appreciated the fact that everyone else has to bear the consequences of that risk that you might take. Okay. Acting is a risky business. So, like all good arguments, I want to go to a desert island in order to try and elucidate what I think is wrong with this picture. So here's my desert island riddle. We've got Jack and Jewel, and they must decide what to do. They're stuck on this island. Jack assesses their reasons for actions, determining he has most reasons to do Jay. He also determines that Jillian has most reasons to support him. Surprise, surprise. Jillian does the exact opposite, determining reasons she has most reason to do G. Similarly, Jack has most reason to support her. Jack and Jillian don't agree. And they reflect upon this, like, they engage in lots of debate. They do everything you might think epistemically is required of them. But Jay and G are inconsistent. There's also a background fact. Jillian is a lot stronger than Jack. So she can coerce him to help her. And look, she, you know, she's a Razzie and she appreciates that her reasons of autonomy, and it'd be a lot better if Jack could just act under his own beliefs. But look, it's just not that strong a reason, really. And of course, to be honest, justice, as she understands it, is much more important, and Jack has a lot more reason to do the things that she says. Okay. So both Jack and Jill accept the realist premises and the structural facts that all have come along to my talk. Now, what do Jack and Jill have best reason to do? And what is it most rational for the trip? So the first thing we might point out is, of course, we don't know what it is they have best reason to do. Why? Because there seems to be something missing, right? Which is, who in fact knows best, if anyone? But of course, there's no more missing here in this story than it is in real life. I mean, if it wasn't in real life, truth does not come, as kind of Walden says, not in persona. So this information is not there. But you might think, look, that's fine, because The Perfectionist has a perfectly good story about rationality here, which is that, let's say, you know, take Jill, that despite looking at all the different, you know, structural facts, she's looked at everything, she should just act on what she has most reason to do. I mean, that seems to be what Encrasia requires. So here's the point of my critique. I want to critique this idea that there is enough so far in this realist picture to give us an academic picture of what is rational for Jack and Jill to do. And I want to say that there's some sort of rational gap. So let's remember that both Jack and Jill recognize their natural epistemic position as defined by the set of structural facts, and hence they both believe that there's some unquantifiable risk that they are wrong. So my crucial point is that this means that their decision to act one way or another on one person's belief or not, is a decision to take a risk in one way or another, to take that unquantifiable risk in one way or another. And so it's clear that there's some risk that must be taken. They have to act on someone's beliefs about what to do. The question I want to ask is, well, whose belief should they act upon? Now, it seems natural to think, oh, well, of course, you know, Jill, for example, should just act on what she believes is right. She should take the risk that she is right. But why? I mean, it is true that on the basis of her first order belief, she may believe not only that all things considered she should do G, but also that she knows best relative to Jack, and that is assumed the vice versa for Jack. However, she also believes that this belief is subject to the very same epistemic limitations of her natural epistemic position. It is precisely this belief about knowing best what that is ultimately at risk of being wrong. She cannot therefore reason that she should take the risk that she is wrong about who knows best because she knows best. So am I suggesting that she then takes the risk that Jack is wrong? Well, the same argument applies. I mean, Jill does not believe that Jack is right. However, this is once again a separate issue about what to take. We haven't provided any reason to take Jack the risk that Jack is wrong. And this is the point. On the perfectionist picture, perfectionists have offered us, within the model I've given of rationality, no reason why any person should take risks based on any person's beliefs. So here's another way of putting it. When we reach a deep disagreement about what to do with a number of actors, we are faced with a set of possible actions that are all relative to each person's belief about what there is best to do. So step inside John's philosophy department again. You've got a table around which there are all there's the Humeans, there's the Kantians, there's the utilitarians, the natural law theorists, and they all seem to offer us different ways in which we can take the risk of what is best to do with the philosophy department and its resources. And the question I want to ask is, well, yeah, each person's yeah, going out each route involves taking risk that one of them, that person is wrong. But which risk should we take? And why should you, it seems that we have a natural instinct to prefer our own, right? To take the risk that our beliefs are right, do it our way. But why? Because you could imagine like there was a button in the middle of the philosophy department table where if you just press that button, your plan would be executed by little philosophy minions for the rest of the year. And everyone can reach over, rest over, and hit that philosophy button. You might think if you reach over and press that button because it was on the beliefs, people might say to you, hey, why did you decide that we were going to risk that you were wrong instead of me, or that person, or that person? Why? What reason did you have for that? And on the perfectionist picture, there is no reason given for that belief. I mean, for example, if we take perfectionists, they cannot apply because this action is what I have best reason to do independent of belief. This is because it's the very risk that this is false that we're facing. Well, at the same time as your fingers hovering over has kind of just finished the button, you can't say, oh, well, this is the action that I believe that we have best reason to do. This is because according to the perfectionist's own premises, my beliefs cannot be reasons for anything in this relevant sense. So instead, if you look at the kind of literature when perfectionists get pressed on this type of point, they say something like this. Because this action is what I have best reason to do, bracket, as I believe, bracket. This is something that Raz originally said to Enoch cited a couple of times. What does that mean? I mean, it's very hard to work out what the propositional content of that statement actually means. Does the bracketed qualification mean the normative statement is relative to the descriptive qualification about belief? Or does the descriptive qualification merely make the preceding statement a descriptive report of a belief about normativity? I mean, if it's the former, then it amounts to the very few that perfectionists reject, that beliefs can ground reasons. If it's the latter, then it's no longer a claim about reasons at all. Okay. So one final way of putting it, I suppose, is to say, at the base, I think, of the political liberal reaction to perfectionists should not be the intuition, you know, the outrage of, well, why are we accepting your beliefs rather than mine, as the finger comes off the button? Or why do your beliefs get more weight than mine? It is, why did you decide that we would take the risk that your belief were right rather than my belief? It's all about risk, and that's what is meant to be different about my argument. Okay, so hopefully you get some sense that there's a gap in the perfectionist picture. But how are we going to fill that gap? So in the first case, we need to explain, what are we trying to explain? We're trying to explain, first of all, an instinct that generally we should act on our own beliefs, and we should take the risk that our own beliefs are false rather than someone else's view. But in doing so, we might also start to find the reason as to why sometimes we shouldn't. In fact, we should restrain acting on our own belief and take the risk that our beliefs are false, and in fact act on someone else's beliefs. Okay. Now, in one sense, our epistemic position is tragic. Here goes the intuitive argument for how to fill this gap. So let's step back. We're in Plato's cave, and in a sense, this is tragic, right? It's a tragic position to be in. With the best of intentions, the greatest motivation to do good, whatever that is what we have most reason to do, all things considered, independent belief, whatever they are, we are unavoidably constrained to our contingent fallible beliefs. In fact, it seems, you know, given the second structural fact, the one about epistemic authority, we seem to be doomed, as it were, to act upon them, to act in accordance with whatever we believe we have to do. The thing about this picture is that it gives no credit to the sheer act of trying to do good, however one conceives of it. In acting in accordance with what we believe we have reason to do, one, we may well fail to conform with what we have best reason to do independent of belief X. However, we shall show respect for X by doing Y, that is, whatever we believe X happens to be. Because after all, Y, what we believe X is, but we might be wrong about, is our best attempt to work out what X is, right? We're sitting in there in a cave, we're trying to work out what's out there in the heaven, and we've come up with these beliefs, and that's our best attempt to respect what's out there in heaven. I kind of have this picture of the political liberals drawing paintings on the inside of the cave, trying to represent what's out there in the world. And that's their attempt to respect that. And acting upon that is an attempt to respect that, despite our, as it were, tragic position. So my claim is that we have a general reason, a decisive reason, in fact, to show respect for X, Plato's heaven, given our epistemic reason. And I call this the basic reason for action. It's something like this. Each individual I has a decisive reason to respect the reasons for action that she has independent of belief X, by complying with what she believes X and to be. And this means it kind of operates effectively as a schema, which means that in any particular situation, any individual has a decisive reason to act RN on the basis of that individual's first order beliefs as to her reasons for action. So the basic reason for action in any scenario, given an individual under the structural facts, in any scenario, it sort of triggers one of these decisive reasons. So to adopt an old term, I think this encapsulates what it means to act in a goodwill, for example. We manifest goodwill when we act in this way. I think it's, in many ways, also consistent with the type of view that was coming out of, for example, Aquinas. So here's John Finnis trying to explain Aquinas' view on conscience. One's conscience is the judgment, sententia, one reaches in trying to apply practical principles, ultimately the first practical principles, natural law, right, to particular types of situations which one is deliberating about, or at least contemplating, acting, or is reflecting on what one did. An erroneous conscience is morally binding simply because to the person in error it seems to be stating the truth. And so, however monstrous my error, I cannot defect from my conscience without being guilty of a willingness to act contrary to the truth. It is the willingness to act to truth that is doing all the work here. It's similar here, it's this Anglican scholastic, Jeremy Taylor. If the conscience be weakly and innocently misguided, there is no sin either in my error or in the consequent action. Because no man is bound to do better than his best, and he hath no sin in the principle of his error, is certain he did his best. That is, he did all his duty, and then to proceed by the best light he hath is agreeable to right reason and religion. And it's no surprise that I find the best support for this type of argument in these type of religious theological views, because there's such a big stream to theology to try to work out precisely what to do in what is God's heaven, given the fact that they feel like the mortals who can't possibly know for sure what God says. It's the same structure played out in Plato's heaven for Enoch, Raz, and all the other perfectionists. So what does this mean? Well, it doesn't mean that when we do act, not everything will go best. And what it means is that we have a decisive reason, it seems, to not make the world go the best it should be. And that might throw you off. In fact, almost certainly, if everyone is acting on what I say is their sort of decisive reason, the world will not go best. But however, this is not as a relevant kind of factual. It is akin to saying that the world would be better off if we're all fallible, but we are not. Our fallibility is a tragedy, and so therefore is our decisive reason for action R that it grounds. So to believe that we have a decisive reason R is to admit that we do not necessarily have best reason as all the fallible individuals in this world to make the world the best it can be. But my response to that is, well, what reason do we ever think
that given our natural epistemic positions, that we had a reason to make the world the best it could possibly be, because we didn't have that capacity. I mean, why is it such a surprising result? Why is it surprising? What reason did we ever have to think that as the limited beings that we are, it was ever our role to make the world the best it can be, rather than the best that we believe it to be? We are limited beings, and therefore we have the reasons of beings so limited. And this also explains, in essence, why I think this reason is decisive. It's decisive because it doesn't play with the other reasons for action. The other reasons are reasons for action. But this is a reason to take a risk. And so, hence, there's no other reasons competing with this one in what you should do with respect to a risk. But because the realm of whether to take a risk or not is itself decisive about whether one acts or not, that reason itself then ends up being decisive relative to the others. Okay. So I'll just finish off why this, I think, leads to the basic proposition, and then I'll try and address some of the objections that you might well have been thinking of. Okay, so the first of is that it leads, at least in my definition, to people having authority over themselves. I can give myself a decisive reason to act in a certain way by forming a belief about on my first order of reasons of what I believe I have to do, and that therefore gives myself a reason to act in that way. And it's decisive over what otherwise existed. Second implication, however, is that because the basic reason for action applies to anyone who is in the natural epistemic position, and presumably everyone here is, that means that anyone in the same position has authority over herself, or at least the type of authority I described in the first implication. So hence we get to the third implication, which is each individual has authority over herself and herself alone, which is the basic proposition. Now this is not the end of the implications, and this is really important. We've just reached the basic problem of politics. We haven't reached its solution. We've reached a reason from the realist premises to believe that everyone in this room has authority over herself in this way. Reasons that are decisive relative to the reasons beneath the first order reasons. But that doesn't necessarily tell us what to do if all of us find out we have decisive reasons to do things that are inconsistent with one another. Now, you might be a Hobbesian, and you think, well, okay, so everyone just goes ahead and acts on that reason. That's what it means for people to be free and equal in this sense. But you might be a Kantian, and you might think a different implication rolls out, a different higher order implication rolls out of the fact that each individual has authority over themselves. Maybe it's the categorical imperative. Or you might be a political liberal. Or you might be a deliberative democrat. All these different views I'm therefore characterising as an attempt to work out, well, what happens now? What happens now that we've realised that everyone here has a decisive reason to act that overrides their lower side reasons, but doesn't necessarily, it seems, mean that they, as it were, can stop others acting on their decisive reasons? So that's a hard question. We've got to work out what it is, and that's why it's... that's meant to be then the rest of politics on this view. Okay, so I've got about 5 minutes, seven minutes. Okay. Objections. Oh, doesn't matter, I'm getting on to objections.
No objections.
So, the first one I want to deal with, there was a number of objections addressed in the paper, so I'll try and get through in order of priority. The first one, I think, is probably the most important one. It's the one you've probably been dying to ask in some shape or form since I started talking about structural fact and epistemology and so forth. How on earth is this not awfully, viciously self-reflexive? Because this type of reasoning, this type of response, which ultimately generally leads anyone who goes down the epistemic route trying to justify politicalism to scurry quickly all the way back. Just a Thomas Nagel kind of scurries down there in the 80s and scurries all the way back in the 90s. So why shouldn't I scurry back? So the objection, the kind of vicious self-servitude objection is something like this. The fact of structural fallibility applies to our second order beliefs as much as our first. As a consequence, we must accept not merely that there is an unquantifiable, illimitable risk that I've got my first order of reasons wrong, but also that I've got my second order beliefs wrong about when and why I have reason to take such a risk. It's wrong, you know, that the unquantifiable fact's going to apply to my reasoning about the risk to take it, to take the fact that my beliefs might be false. And for any response at this level, the argument can be recursively repeated ad infinitum. So it follows that at some point I must just simply act upon my beliefs about the reasons that I have for action as if I were infallible, and thus why not simply do this at the first order? So I've gone all, you know, I've done all this stuff about structural fallibility, and you got to see, well, I seem to be saying that must incapacitate us, and then I've gone on this kind of lovely walk through intuitive argument about caves and heaven and everything, and I say, well, that could be wrong too, Nicholas. In fact, it's the same motivation that started off seems to apply to your reasoning here. So, have you got us anyway? Okay, this is why I have got this here. First of all, here to find, some clarifications. First, at no point in my argument has it ever been contended that one can only act if one's action is without risk of being wrong, or that one must believe that one's action is without risk of being wrong. Instead, the point has been, in order to be rational, remember that was what I started off with, I was saying, look, the perfectionist picture doesn't seem to leave a rational gap, and I'm trying to explain what it is rational to do. The point has been that in order to be rational, one requires a belief in a reason to take a risk. So I'm not saying that belief has to be true. I'm just saying you have to have a belief in a reason in order to take, in order to be rational, in order for the rational sort of calculus, so to speak, to determinately allow you to act. So secondly, let us be precise about the risk that we face given the fact of structural fallibility. The risk that each of us faces is that any one of our beliefs about the reasons that we have for action, all things considered, may be false. And therefore, we will not have such a reasons for action, all things considered. This risk, therefore, applies to beliefs at any order. So the structural fact, it applies to beliefs at any order, including beliefs about what to do given the structural fact. But my point is that I believe this entirely general fact gives me the entirely general decisive reason to take the risk that any belief about what I have reason to do, all things considered, is false. So we have an entirely general fact, structural fallibility. We also have an entirely general reason. So what does this mean when we assess the perfectionist reply? So the perfectionist is pointing out that given the entirely general fact about structural fallibility, there is a risk that my belief in R may be false. You know, this whole schmozzle about Plato and everything, and Plato's case, well, that could be false. And I accept that is true. However, that doesn't undermine my belief in R. Actually, it supports my belief in R. Right? The fact that my belief in R could be false is virtuously self-reflexive rather than viciously self-reflexive. Because it's the very fact that any of beliefs might be false is what gives me reason to believe that I have this entirely general reason to act on what I believe what my beliefs are. So there's actually no logical inconsistency with that. It seems to be counterintuitive that the fact that my belief could be false is a reason to have that belief. But actually, you're seeing the same structure for the fact of structural fallibility itself, because presumably, it's self-referring. And if it wasn't, that would undermine our belief in the fact of structural fallibility. So in fact, my belief in the fact of structural fallibility could be false is a reason to believe that the fact of structural fallibility is true. The same logic applies for the decisive reason R. Isn't that why it is virtuously self-reflexive? So the error that the perfectionist commits, therefore, is that while she appreciates the entirely general nature of the fact of structural fallibility, she fails to appreciate the entirely general nature of the belief in decisive reason R. Instead, she assumes that this belief is merely a second-order belief, which can always be undermined by the internal entirely general fact of structural fallibility. This is incorrect because the belief in R is not merely a second order belief, it is equally general. Tom? Okay, so there are a number of other responses to objections that you've probably also thought of. We can address, so one's about higher order disagreement, in particular, as well as obviously Nazis and bootstrapping, which I'm sure will come at some stage. Thank you.
Very pleased to be able to give comments on it. I will confess right from the beginning that I fall in the camp that just doesn't get it. So I'll tell you why. Let me start with by just saying that I'm not going to refer to having authority over yourself. I think that that language may potentially mislead what the content of the claims are. So I'm going to put it in different language, focusing on when the claims are getting fleshed out in the paper. So Nicholas Kirby argues for the basic proposition, which you've heard. I'm going to put it in these terms. I have a natural, underived, or as he says, fundamental ability to create a decisive reason for myself to phi by determining that I should phi on the basis of my belief-independent reasons. And then the negative claim, no one else has the natural ability to create a decisive reason for me to phi by determining that I should phi on the basis of my belief-independent reasons. So the clause about belief-independent reasons arises not early on in the paper, but later, but it turns out to play a very important role in the argument, as we'll see. My comments are in two parts. The first, I'm going to focus on the basic proposition and its implications, so trying to figure out what it actually is and what its implications look like. And then second, I will turn to the argument for the basic proposition that's given in the paper. So about what this basic proposition is, three questions of clarification. What does determine mean? We get to the substance, when we get to the substance of the paper, and actually it was clarified for me in the presentation, it looks like determine means belief. I'm pretty sure this is what is meant, except I'm even more confident now, having heard the presentation. So what it means is that I'm able to create a decisive reason when I believe that I should X or phi. But when mobilizing our intuitions in favor of the basic proposition, Kirby appeals to things like acquiring voluntary obligations by a contract, agreeing with others, and what I want to point out is that even the term agreement has the same equivocation between a kind of epistemic sense of agreement. I agree with you insofar as I believe that the proposition that you also believe. But agreeing in the performative sense is different, the one that we engage in contract, where we come to agree that we commit ourselves to doing something. So that really has nothing to do with the kind of argument that's being presented here. So I don't think that the talk about contract or agreement in that performative sense is helpful. Actually, I think it's misleading. Unless there's an argument for why these two should be related somehow. Second, why is the basic proposition formulated in terms of our ability? Is it because you think that it's not just the belief that I should phi that gives me a decisive reason to phi, but my belief combined with some other mental act, such as a decision? In other words, we have to exercise this ability in some other way, such that the belief is necessary but not sufficient. Nothing is really said in the paper about this, so I'm not exactly sure. But again, based on sort of trying to figure it out in the paper and the presentation, I think that actually just means that our belief is sufficient in some way. But I might be wrong about that. So I'm going to assume that that's what it means. That formulation is in line with the requirement of rationality that's stated in the paper in rough terms, what's called enkrasia here. So I assume that's what it is. Third question of clarification, what does decisive reason mean? In the paper, it's explained, it's equated to a sufficient reason, as I understand it. To say that I have a sufficient reason to phi, whether phi is a belief, feeling, or action, is to say that I'm not, all things considered, criticizable for doing that thing. I'm not making an all things considered mistake in doing it. I may not make all things considered mistakes by not doing it, but I don't do a mistake by doing it either. Another way to put this is that if I have a sufficient reason to do something, then it's not the case that I ought not to do it, though it's not necessarily the case that I ought to either. And that second part is something that I think that you want to hang on to. But by the time we get to the end of the paper, it turns out that decisive reason means something quite different than what I just said in the paper. It doesn't mean that I'm not criticizable for doing something. It doesn't mean that I ought not to do it. All that it seems to mean, a decisive reason that is that it's a reason of a second rank or order amongst three orders of reasons with mounting lexical priority. So that's what I want to get to. So what are these three orders of reasons that appear in the paper? You've only heard about two. The third one is very important for the Nazi objection. So the first order, reasons that I have independently of my beliefs. Okay. So what's the second order reason? This is the crux of the paper. The reason I have arising from the basic proposition, namely, the reason I have to do things in virtue of my belief that given my first order, belief independent reasons, I should do them. Okay. So why is this called a decisive reason? I think it's called a decisive reason in the paper because Nicholas would like to say that it preempts and replaces my first order reasons. Again, the presentation, I think, it gave me more confidence that that's what is meant by this. So it's lexically stronger, as he puts it in the paper. So whatever my first order reasons are to why, if I believe that I should X, then I have a reason to X that preempts all of those other reasons. This seems like a crazy view to me. It seems to imply that our beliefs about what we ought to do just make it the case that we really ought to do it. And so that's the Nazi example, right? So who believes that he should torture and kill certain minorities really should do those things. And Nicholas in the paper has a response to this, and here's where things get tricky. He posits a third order of reasons, which has lexical priority over the first and the second. So here's the third order reason. The reason I have, that's this third order reason, is the reason I have to respect other people's ability to create second order decisive reasons for themselves in virtue of their normative beliefs. So Nicholas thinks that respecting this ability requires refraining from preventing others from acting from their own second order reason. In other words, according to what they themselves believe they should do. Presumably this implies not killing and torturing them because that would prevent them from doing what they believe that they should do. So here's the picture, I take it. The Nazi has a second order decisive reason to kill and torture people, but he also has a third order reason to refrain from killing and torturing, and this third order reason trumps his decisive second order one. So all things considered, he ought to refrain. So there's a minor problem here, just a minor one. I think it's misleading, therefore, to call that second order reason a decisive reason in this context. I find it very confusing. But I think on reflection, I understand what's being said here. It's a second order reason, lexically prior to the first order ones, but nevertheless, defeasible by third order ones. So there's two big problems here. I don't see any defense for why the fact that we have second order decisive reasons to act on our normative beliefs, if it is a fact, as Kirby's basic proposition claims it is, implies that we should refrain from preventing others from acting on their own second order reason. As far as I can tell, the fact, if it is a fact, that each person's belief creates reasons for her, just creates reasons for her, not for others. That's not part of the basic proposition. So why doesn't the fact that you have a decisive reason to act on your belief about the first order reasons just imply that you're not blameworthy for doing so? In other words, you don't have any first order epistemic reasons for, I don't have any epistemic reason for blaming you for doing so. I might try to coercively prevent you from acting on those beliefs, all the while recognizing that you don't have any reason to do otherwise. And so that's what Hobbes says about the sovereign. Right? The sovereign can does no wrong in executing the criminal, and the criminal does no wrong in resisting. Put another way, all that the basic proposition shows is that my beliefs can create a reason for me. It doesn't show why it creates reasons for anyone else, other than reasons to recognize what my new reason is. But it's still my reason. Now, second point. This is the second reason. Even if somehow Nicholas could establish that people have a reason to respect others in the sense that he's talking about, which I don't think he does. That's the point of the first reason. I don't understand why this supposedly third order reason isn't just a plain old first order reason. Why is it a third order reason that gets to trump the second order one? After all, it's a belief independent reason. The Nazi does not believe he has any reason to refrain from preventing others from acting on their own beliefs or to refrain from killing and torturing. But in Nicholas's story, the Nazi does have a reason to refrain from killing and torturing. So if he does have such a reason, it must be a belief independent reason. But that's what first order reasons are. At least that's what we're supposed to be. So why isn't this just a first order reason that's lexically weaker than the Nazi's second order reason to do what he believes he should do? That's what the basic proposition says, after all. Okay, so what's the argument for the basic proposition? That's why I think this is a crazy view, but I'm going to give you what the argument is supposed to be for the basic proposition. The setup, as you saw in the presentation, there's these three structural premises. Fallibility, my moral beliefs could be possibly wrong. Epistemic authority, I have an ultimate epistemic authority over myself. And unquantifiable risk that's supposed to fall out of that. Let me say something about epistemic authority. I think the argument for why we have epistemic authority over ourselves is flawed. What's the argument? Well, it's supposed to be, Nicholas says that I have an ultimate epistemic authority over myself because as a matter of psychological fact, I can only have the beliefs that I do and act on the beliefs that I have. So even if I believe that you have epistemic authority over me, ultimately it's me who believes that you have authority over me. But to assert that someone has epistemic authority is to say something normative, not to describe a non-normative fact. In other words, you can't get a claim about authority over yourself by just pointing to some psychological non-normative fact. So it's presumably to say that X has epistemic or theoretical, X has epistemic or theoretical authority for Y is to say that the fact that X believes some proposition P furnishes a reason, perhaps a peremptory reason, for why it's believed that P. To say that I have epistemic authority over myself seems to be saying that the fact that I have a reason to believe some proposition itself provides me with a further reason, perhaps a peremptory reason, to believe that proposition. But none of that follows from the non-normative fact that I have the beliefs that I do and that I ultimately act on my own beliefs. When I have beliefs or act on my beliefs, nothing compels me to give my beliefs any authority at all, whether epistemic or practical. I can just believe what I do. For example, the fact that I believe some proposition does not imply that my belief has any authority. I just believe it. That's it. There's nothing here about authority. Okay, now what's the argument for the basic proposition? The argument is this. Because I'm in no position to assess whose beliefs are more likely to be true or false, that's that business about risk. I have a decisive reason to act on my own assessment of my first order reasons. What's the argument for that? Because it's my own assessment. It seems to be two problems here. Maybe I've misunderstood the paper, but that's all I could figure out as far as the argument goes, what that argument is, and maybe this is where I've misunderstood the paper, so I apologize. So here's what I think the problem is. I think it's just begging the question, why should I act on my own assessment? Because it's my own assessment. That's not a justification, that just reasserts what needs to be justified. Okay, so that's what seems to me to be the crux of the problem that I have with the paper. Now, there's another bit here, which is that the argument appeals also to a much stronger premise than what he's calling unquantifiable risk. Unquantifiable risk has two parts, my beliefs may be mistaken, and the second part, that my judgments about how probable my beliefs are and how probable other people's beliefs are, and the standards that I use to make such judgments might also be mistaken. Certainly would grant that. But from this, it doesn't follow that I never have sufficient reason to believe that my or your judgments in some domain are more probably true than someone else's. That's just a much stronger premise that's being appealed to. And that seems to me a skepticist premise, so I'm surprised that it's being appealed to. Do I have time to, am I up?
No,
one more minute?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll just end with the tourist example, since you know we want to give our examples. There's a man who wants to get to the other side of the river. He has a decisive moral reason to do so. Indeed, he ought to get to the other side within the hour. The only way to do so is by crossing the bridge. There's two bridges. Only one of them is within the sight of this man. He's a tourist. He only speaks English. He doesn't know about the other bridge, and he doesn't know about the war. The bridge he sees is actually mine. Anyone who steps on it dies instantly. I live here. We all have seen bridges explode. And we have plenty of evidence that this first bridge is mine, while the other, not quite visible, is not. Our scientists have conducted tests, and they've always been right in the past. So I believe this bridge is mine. I also know, based on plenty of past experience, that unilingual Anglo tourists to our country are pretty clueless about these mines. The tourist only sees the mine bridge. He's going for it. I don't speak English. None of us do. The only way to stop the silly guy from unintentionally blowing himself up is to run fast and push him out of the way. If you don't think that suddenly pushing people out of the way counts as coercion, then consider the variant of the story. The only way to stop him is to run over and point a gun at him and gesture for him to move from the bridge, maybe until a translator arrives so we can tell him about the other bridge. I think Nicholas wants to say two things about this case. First, the tourist, having evaluated his reasons, including moral reasons, believes he should cross the mined bridge. This gives him a decisive second-order reason to cross. Since he's not disrespecting anyone else's ability to give themselves reasons, there's no third-order reason that trumps it, so he ought to cross the mined bridge. Really? I find this crazy. After you hear this story, is that really how you would advise the guy? You know, yeah, you ought to cross the bridge.
It's true that you ought to cross the bridge.
No, I don't think that's true.
Second, I, the native, I think this is another implication of his view, I, the native, have a third order reason not to coercively save the tourist. I ought not to do it.
Why? I have a third order reason to refrain from preventing him from acting on his own second order reason.
Why?
Because I supposedly have no basis on which to judge the relative probability of whether my judgments about, or his, about whether he should cross the bridge are true.
Really?
I can fully recognize that, yes, I might be wrong. I can even recognize that the standards according to which I'm judging who's likely to more be right may be wrong. But none of that is going to, so I can recognize my fallibility. None of this is going to produce the holy skepticist premise that I think the argument needs to get me to refrain from acting on my confidence that he's not aware of the relevant facts.